Our dear viewers and listeners, we greet you all in the wonderful and precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is the day the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Therefore, welcome you to today's Bible study as we continue our journey in the book of Revelation. Before we begin, let's dedicate this moment to God in prayer.
Father, we thank you, King of Glory. Yes, we welcome your presence, yes, your power, and your glory. Yes, let your word come alive today, King of Glory.
Yes,
let your presence, let your purpose for which you gave us this word come to life in our hearts,
yes,
and all the hearers, that they may see Christ crucified as the redemption for mankind,
yes,
that they may escape the way to hell and receive salvation. We give you the praise, the glory, the power in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Last week, we looked at heaven's preparation to release the final set of judgment upon the earth. And this will happen at the end of the age. Now, what we saw was a very clear demonstration that at this point in time, which was referenced by the smoke coming from the temple, and the scripture say nobody could get into the temple, which was the symbol or the message from heaven that at this point in time, when the judgments of God are going out, the judgments that we describe as the bowl judgments, at that point in time, there will not be any mercy. There will be no access to the mercy seat. There will be no way to appeal to God for leniency. The door of opportunity will have closed, and God's wrath will be poured out full measure upon the sinful, upon the wicked on the earth. Now you may ask yourself, why all that against the wicked? Because you see, this is what sin does to us. Sin has a way of making so many people blindsided to what its impacts are. So many people today are so oblivious of how sin operates. Why? Because putting it in a nutshell, sin deceives. You see, first of all, sin deceives us by promising that what it can never deliver. Sin will tell you, go ahead. It is fun. Sin tells you, go ahead, enjoy it. You have a short time to live. Make the best out of what you have right now. Sin tells you you will feel better. You will be more fulfilled. Life will be better for you. Then it deceives you by convincing you that what happens to others will never happen to you. It then progresses by creating in you a desire for that which you well know will hurt you. And when you indulge in it, spiritual insensitivity now sets in. omwoyo watandika okukala nga takyawulira.
Christ stops being real to you.
Nga Kristo takyali muntu gw'omanyi.
And you stop looking up to him for support.
Nga tokyamwesigamako.
The Holy Spirit ceases to be your vital companion in life.
Omwoyo omutukuvu alekerawo okubeera omukwano gw'onfanfe mu bulamu bwe.
Your heart becomes callous to his beatings.
Omutima negukala eri ebiragiro bye.
You get hardened to his promptings. You get evasive to where he tries to nudge
you.
And as a result of that, unbelief now sets in. So now you begin to think that you are getting away with it. After all, nothing bad has happened so far. But the text that we saw and what we will develop on today, this journey does not go very far. Because there is coming a day when God will step in and he will call an account of every man and every woman for the life you lived while on earth, and whether Jesus was your personal Lord and Savior. So let's get into today's text, and we'll be taking it from the book of Revelation chapter 16. We shall be reading from verse 1 to verse 16. Let's read. Then I heard a loud voice from the temple saying, to the seven angels, go and pour out the bowels of the wrath of God on the earth. So the first went and poured out his bowel upon the earth, and a foul and loathsome sore came upon men who had the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image. Then the second angel poured out his bowl on the
sea,
and it became blood as of a dead man, and every living creature in the sea died. Then the third angel poured out his bowl on the rivers and the springs of water, and they became blood. And I heard the angel of the water saying, you are righteous, O Lord, the one who is and who was and who is to be, because you have judged these things. For they have shed the blood of saints and prophets, and you have given them blood to drink. For it is their just due. And I heard another from the altar saying, even so, Lord God Almighty, true and righteous are your judgments. Then the fourth angel poured out his bowl on the sun, and the power was given to him to scorch men with fire, and men were scorched with great heat, and they blasphemed the name of God who has power over these plagues, and they did not repent and give him glory. Then the fifth angel poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast, and his kingdom became full of darkness, and they gnawed their tongues because of the pain They blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores. And did not repent of their deeds. Then the sixth angel poured out his bowl on the great river Euphrates. And its waters dried up. So that the way of the kings from the east might be prepared. And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs coming out of the mouth of the dragon. Out of the mouth of the beast. And out of the mouth of the false prophet. For they are the spirits of demons, performing signs which go out to the kings of the earth and of the whole earth. Whole
world
to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. Behold, I am coming as a thief. Blessed is he who watches and keeps his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. And they gathered them together to the place called in Hebrew
Armageddon.
Today, we are going to look at these six judgments. And next week, we will move a few verses back and then be able to complete the seventh judgment. So as we pick it up today, we begin to look at the seven bowls judgment that are poured out. And what we see of the six that are revealed here and the seventh that we will see, we begin to see a similarity between the trumpets and the bowl judgments. So in both, the first series or the first series of judgments, the trumpets that we saw in chapter 8 and verse 7, when we compare it with chapter 16 and verse
2,
and the second series is the one that we see in chapter 8 from verse 8 to 9.
And
we see the same in chapter 16, verse
3.
The first series was judgment upon the earth. The second series was a judgment that was upon the sea. The third series, which we see in chapter 8 from verse 10 to verse
11,
when you look at chapter 16 verse
4,
we see the wrath or the judgment poured out on the rivers and the fountains of water. The fourth series, which deals with the sun, is what we see in chapter 8 and verse 12. And we compare that to chapter 16 and verse 8. The fifth series is what we see In chapter 8, verse 12. Musule yomunano runyiririwa 12. And when we compare that with chapter 16 and verse 10. Irojigeragera ne sura ya 16 no runyiririwa 10. This series deal with darkness. Jine misango jikolagana nechizikiza. The sixth series. Emisango ejo mukaga. Which we see in chapter 9. Verse 13. When you compare with chapter 16, verse 12, these deal with the river Euphrates. Now, the seventh, which we will see next week, begins with chapter 11. Verse 9. And then we see the same happening in chapter 16 from verse 17 to 21. This deal with lightning, with thunder, and with earthquakes. Now, when you look at all this, we also notice that there are some striking differences. Because the first four bowl trumpet judgments, decimated a third of the earth. Yet when we look at the bowl judgments, these are universal in scope. They cover the earth end to end. Secondly, we see an increase in intensity. We see an increase in coverage. We see an increase in impact. The bowl judgment falls so quickly. Like somebody would get a bowl and pour out its liquid contents. They are coming in a rush. And they are intended to deliver a message to a people that God's tolerance for sin has ended. But what do we see next? In the same text, we look at the impact of this judgment. What we notice is the increasing hardening of the people's hearts. It is like we saw in Egypt, when the plagues came upon Egypt and Pharaoh. And no wonder we see the same plagues come upon these people in the latter time. But what happens? Their callousness, their hardness of heart just builds up. They, in anger, they continue to blaspheme God. But God uses the same things like it was to in Egypt to bring him glory, to bring him honor, and to bring him praise. These judgments will crush man's rebellion. They will remove man that is rebellious from the earth. And they will accomplish the setup of Christ's kingdom on the earth. Let's look at the first judgment. Verse 1-2. Talks about the painful sores that come upon the people. Now, what this is described, they use a Greek word mega. And English is inept in terms of interpreting it.
Because
the words that are used are words like great or fierce.
But here
they want to show you something.
Because
there is a voice that is commanding the release of this judgment. And the Bible calls it a great voice. Most probably the voice from God Almighty Himself. And here we see, if we read through the entire text, the continued use of the word mega. In verse 9, we see the great heat. Verse 12, we see the great Euphrates. Verse 14, we see the great day of God Almighty. Verse 18, we see the great earthquake. Such as has not been seen since man came upon the earth. We see the great city of Babylon. And then we will see the great hailstorm. Now all this is heaven trying to prepare us to give us a peek into what is going to happen. I believe that words cannot fully describe what will happen. Look at this. When the first angel obeys
Malaika the command
and pours out his bowl on the earth, the Bible says there was a loathsome. Now, a loathsome and malignant sore. Now, loathsome is the Greek word kakos, which means evil and injurious. This is like a cancer that is painful and destructive. It creates such an intensity of pain upon whom it is released. Why? Because look at it this way. When the Antichrist shows up and the prophet, one of the things that will characterize their movement will be the performance of miracles. Now, when this judgment is released, the Bible says it is intended for those that have received the mark of the beast. And this will be incurable. There is no amount of miraculous work by the Antichrist or Satan or his prophet that will bring healing to these people. This will be heaven's statement that we can only liken to the boils that God released upon the Egyptians in Exodus chapter 9. If you read from verse 9 going forward, and as soon as this has been released, the Bible tells us that a second angel then pours out their bowl, and the sea became blood as of a dead man. Now, what does it mean by blood as of a dead man? You have seen these graphic pictures of a person who is dead and they are in a pool of blood. Now, that is a very graphic picture.
Ekifaananyi ekyo kya ntiisa.
The Bible here says,
ne Bible yeyogera,
every living thing,
buli kitonde kiramu,
in the sea will die.
Ekiri mu nnyanja kirifa.
This judgment is universal.
Omusango guno gwa nsi yonna.
It will cause a global catastrophe.
Wajja kubeera wakatabanguko mu nsi zonna.
That is never been seen anywhere.
Nga tekirabikangako.
Remember, we have seen this at the trumpet.
Twabiraba bino mu biseera bya byobugo.
In chapter 8.
Musule y'omunana.
But this is more intense.
Ate kino kyeyongerako
mu this is wider in scope.
Kigazi kikona ku bintu.
It will wreck the fishing industry.
Kijja kuyingira ne mu buvubi kibyonoonye.
It will attack navigation.
Kirumba ebintu byonna eby'okumazzi.
It will affect shipping. It will affect transportation.
Kyonoona okutambula ku mazzi ne ku nguudo.
It will wreck livelihoods.
Obulamu bw'abantu n'ebyenfuna bijja kwonoona.
Of many people that have relied upon the waters for support.
Abo bonna abeesigamanga ebyenfuna biva mu nnyanja.
Now, then we see the third judgment being released.
Omusango gw'okusatu nagwo ne gusumululwa.
When the third bowl was released,
ng'ebbakuli y'okusatu emaze okuyiibwa,
this attacks the fresh water supply.
Eyingira mu mazzi gano ge tukozesa.
So, at that moment,
akaseera,
there will be no pure water.
Nga tekyali mazzi malongoofu.
All rivers,
ensulo,
all lakes,
ennyanja,
will be covered with blood.
Nga zonna zifuuse musaayi.
And here the Bible brings about a certain living being whom they call the angel of the waters.
Bible n'etuleetera ekiramu kye bayita malayika ow'oku nnyanja.
And this one,
malayika ono,
apparently I believe is in charge of the waters at this point.
Mu kaseera ako nzikiriza yajja kuba
avunaanyizibwa
okukakasa
that God's judgment
emisango Katonda
gy'asala
gituuse
in full measure
mu busungu bwazo
upon all fresh water.
Eri amazzi gonna.
Just imagine this scenario where there is no water for people to drink.
Kubamu ekifaananyi nga tekyali mazzi bantu ge bafuna okunywa.
And the Bible tells us,
Bible egamba,
why does this happen?
Lwaki kibaawo?
It is because in their bloodthirstiness,
kubanga mu kwagala okutta,
they had killed many.
Baiwo omusaayi gw'abantu bangi.
Upon the face of the earth.
Ku nsi kuno.
So now God pays them back for kind.
Katonda n'abasasula ekyo kye baakola kyennyini.
You see, there is something about sin that I did not mention.
Mulimu ekizibu ekiri mu kibi kye
sitaakugamba. Sin is like a seed.
Ekibi kiri ng'ensigo.
Whatever you sow,
kyonna ky'osiga,
you will reap.
Ojja kikungula.
Sin grows.
Ekibi kikula.
Sin bears fruit.
Ekibi kibala.
And so whatever sins you begin to sow, without repentance, without God's forgiveness, it will come back to you in the same measure. Because the seed produces after its kind. When you sow something, you reap more than you sow.
Kyonna ky'osiga amakungula gabeera ga muyiika.
So it is the same kind.
Kyonna ky'okoze.
But it is more than what you actually sowed.
Okungula ekyo kye wasiga naye ng'ate kya muyiika okusinga kye wasiga.
And it will happen after you have sowed.
Ate kijja ng'omaze okusooka kusiga.
So right now it may look like you are getting away with it.
Kati olabikanga gwe wayitawo bwisiteri kabika kujjako.
But it is only a matter of time.
Naye kaseera kagere.
So why there is still an opportunity?
Ng'okyayina omwagaanyi.
You don't want to get to this place.
Toyagala kutuuka mu kifo
kyo. Where the only thing you have to drink is blood.
Nga ky'osigazza okunywa si mazzi naye musaayi.
And in verse 5,
mu lunyiriri olw'okutaano,
we are given the reason why this can happen.
But w'ensonga lwaki kibaawo?
Because there is one who is.
Kubanga waliyo ono ali.
And there is one who were.
Waliwo ye yali.
So he is, he was there, he is now, and he will be there forever.
Ali yaliwo ate alibeawo mirembe na mirembe.
So that is the guarantee.
Bwe bukakafu.
That whatever has been declared,
byonna ebyayogerwa,
will come to pass. Because the one who declares it is a constant denominator through all time. And then we see the fourth bulb. Now all these are happening at a rapid interval, one after the other. And the impact of this is upon the sun. We saw previously when the trumpet was sounded, it did impact by diminishing the light by one third. So the earth will be living under conditions of judgment. And that's heaven's constant reminder to men to repent. But now, the sun is impacted in such a way that there is such a tremendous heat upon the people that has been released with such an intensity. I believe that there is nothing humanly possible that people will be able to do to guard themselves against this heat that will come upon them. You see, today we hear a lot of people talking about global warming. And others are talking about, no, the earth is cooling and all that stuff. But the fact is, what the Bible describes here is so intense that its impact will be felt and there will be nothing like cooling off. So I want you to look at this. That the sun will burn men with fire. I believe that would be like taking away the entire ozone layer and having the rays coming directly to man. So this, I believe, is a fulfillment of what was prophesied in the book of Psalms, chapter 19. And verse 6, the Bible says, there is nothing hid from the heat of the sun. I believe this was a prophetic saying to what will happen at this time. Where the rays of the sun will penetrate anything that is upon the earth. And the heat will be so unbearable that the Bible says it will scorch the men with fire. It will be such a fierce heat. And the men upon the earth at that time, we know the cause. It will not be what they have done or what they have not done. They will know that this is coming because of God's wrath being poured upon us. And watch their reaction. The Bible says they will blaspheme the name of God. So they recognize the source of the plagues. But they will be so hardened of heart. They have reached a point of no return. And whatever happens to them, because they took the mark of the beast, even this, when it comes upon them, they will continually blaspheme God. Like I keep saying, at this point in time, the day, the time for repentance is no more. It is men that are hardened. It is men that are destined for doom.
Abantu abateeketeekebwa okuzikirira.
Then we go to the fifth bowl.
Tuyingira mu bakuli eyokutaano.
Verse 10 to verse 11.
Onyere 10 ne 11.
And this results into total darkness. I believe it will be similar to the darkness that Egypt experienced. When you read Exodus chapter 10, verse 21 to 23, the Bible describes that darkness. It says it was pitch darkness. That could be felt. Such darkness like you cannot imagine. Now, look at the object of this darkness. And I believe this is both literal, but it is also symbolic. Like I also believe the one, the attack on the rivers will both be physical, but it will also be symbolic. Here, the target is the throne of the beast. Here, what is being attacked is the person, as well as the system the beast has put in place. This will be attacked by darkness. You see, when the Antichrist comes in place, he will show up as the solution to the world. He will come as the Messiah to humanity. He will come as the problem solver to all the issues tormenting mankind at that time. Now that wisdom, or the fountain of that wisdom, I believe, with the destruction of the fresh water, that wisdom will be done away with. And it will be darkened. Now, this is the next bowl, judgment. So there will be no more illumination. It will be total pitch darkness. No more solutions. The next time we will see that later, the only thing that will be propagated will be lies, lies, and lies, and lies. You see, this is what had happened in chapter 13 of the book of Revelation. We see that the beast from the land, from the water, who is the Antichrist, receives power from Satan, and as a result becomes the object of man's worship. And men will marvel at the beast and begin to say, like, words like, who is like the beast? Who can make war against him? Now, he is seen as the solution, because he has solved some of the conditions of the world. When things looked hopeless, he has solved the Middle East crisis. Before he shows up as the man of lawlessness. And then here, he's able to gather so many to him. The scientists will come under his umbrella. The philosophers will come under his umbrella. The researchers will come. The politicians will come. The kings, the princes will come. The presidents and the rulers will flock to him as the solution. So he then is raised above men. And they begin to see him.
nebatandika okumulaba
as God.
Ngakatu.
Now it is at that point
akasera
where everything achieves its intended goal.
Ngabuli bigendera byonna bituukiridde ku ntuuko yaayo.
So the bow that comes now
kati ebakuli eyibwa wano
is intended to this system.
Ejja kuyibwa ku nkola
eneteekeddwa. It is intended to bring down everything.
Ejja kusula n'okusaanya buli kimu
that has been established.
N'enkola zonna ezaali ziteekeddwawo
by the Antichrist.
Ezo omulabe wa Kristo.
Jesus put it so well.
Yesu akinnyonnyola.
In the book of Matthew,
Matayo,
chapter 15, he says every plant that has not been planted by my Father will be uprooted. So every system that will be established by the Antichrist, however gigantic, however enormous, however grandiose it may appear, it will be brought down. It will crumble. There is a turning point when this bowl is poured out on the beast's throne and every place of his rule. Every place of his influence. Neither man nor devil will be able to alleviate this judgment. This will be the clear message to those at that time that there has always been only one hope. And that hope was the eternal God who put on flesh, was born in a manger in Bethlehem, lived a normal life, demonstrated the mercy and the love and the power of God, fulfilled every requirement of the law, and died for the sins of mankind. His name is Jesus Christ. And he alone is the light of the world. So the darkness now begin makes the statement that he was the light. Every other person can only have light. The light that he gives. Besides him, other than him, everything else is darkness. This darkness anticipates doom. To Satan, to the beast, and to all their subordinates. Why? Because they have turned away from the light of the world. Let's look at the effect. The Bible says his kingdom became darkened. So it was enveloped by darkness. Secondly, the Bible tells us that men gnawed their tongues because of the pain. There is an accumulating effect from what we have seen from the first bowl. Now, don't think that when the first judgment is passed, then when heaven pours out the second one, it stops the first. No, the first one is added onto the second one, and each of those is increasing in intensity.
Buli bakuli jaiwa yeyongerayo eriyesanga jinanga zeyongerayo zonna ziyiwayo nga zeyongera teri mukoma.
So by the time we are getting to the fifth,
watutuka mu yokutano,
the first one has already gone to intensity by so many degrees.
Gabakuli yasoko kuyiwa nayo yeyongerayo mu busungu.
And so is the second, and so is the third, and so is the fourth.
Neyo kusatu neyo kuna.
Such chaos
laba kavuya
that you cannot possibly imagine.
Nga tusobola nakaluuza ko.
Men are shut where they are. They are in sores. They are in pain.
Abantu bali mu biwundu na birwadde na bulumi.
Nothing can help them. No drugs can help
them.
No vaccination can help them. There is no immunization. There is no concoction. Nothing can alleviate this pain. But again, what do we see in verse 11? That they did not repent of their deeds. Think about it. In spite of what is happening, they continue to be stubborn. They will continue in their rebellion. And then we see the sixth bowl poured out. And this sixth bowl that we see from verse 12 to verse 16, the Bible says the great river Euphrates dried up. So this was what was creating a boundary between the east of Rome, ancient Rome, and the west of ancient Rome. So when it dries up, it then prepares a way for what the Bible calls the kings of the east to now cross and come to attack Israel. Here is something very interesting, because the kings of the east, that means most likely these are nations that will come from the eastern part where the sun is believed to rise.
Abakabaka bana abave banjuba tutebereza nti bebano abave no musana jegwa enjuba je yambu.
And it is believed these are nations like China.
Abawanga tukiriza galinga aga China.
Nations like India, Pakistan.
Agebuyindi
Turkey, these nations will then come from this other side, cross the Euphrates, and come to attack Israel. But I also want you to see something. Why are they coming? Because verse 13 and verse 14 provides us with heaven's bird's view of why this is happening. Because evil spirits have now been released from the dragon, from the beast, and from the false prophet. They have churned out their magic. And as they are doing these miracles, they are getting all these nations to gang up together and come and wage war against Israel. I believe in this time there will be so many anti-Semitic nuances that go on. And it is this atmosphere that will create the perfect environment for the Antichrist now. Remember, initially he was a peacemaker. Now, he comes to release his vengeance upon what he perceives, upon whom he perceives to be the one that is responsible for the situation that he's enduring right now. And this, the Bible tells us, will be at a place called Armageddon. Or a place called Megiddo. Now, we will pick this more into the next one. But why is the Bible telling us all this? Here, God is preparing a message to us to tell us that there is still time. There is still a narrow window of opportunity. And that window of opportunity is today. So today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. Jesus wants to save you. The Bible tells us that God sent his son Bible
gamba, Katonda yatuma omwana we,
that the world may be saved through him. You need a savior, and Jesus is the savior that you need. So why don't you pray with us and you invite Jesus in your life as your personal savior? For the Bible tells us that you believe with your heart and you are justified, and you confess with your mouth and you are saved. Why don't you believe with your heart the Lord Jesus, that he rose from the dead and justified you, and you receive his forgiveness? He will wash away your sins and give you a new life. Say this prayer with me. Say, dear God, I am a sinner. I need a savior in my life. I don't want to face your judgment. Therefore, Lord, forgive my sins. I believe that Jesus is the Savior of the world. Jesus, I receive you in my heart as my Lord and as my Savior. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Guide my footsteps from this moment onward. Write my name, Lord, in the Lamb's Book of Life, that from this day forward my life will bear fruit of righteousness, that from this day forward my life will be lived for you. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Amen. Now, for you that is saved today, there is a number on your screen. Please call that number. God, tell us what God has done in your life. Let's celebrate with you. And somebody will give you the first steps as you begin on this journey in the newness of life. Now, for you who is saved, this is your message too. We have seen what is going to happen. This is heaven's email to you. This is heaven's message to you. To get out of your seat and go and preach this gospel and reach as many people as possible with the gospel of grace while there is still an opportunity, so that as many as possible will be brought into the kingdom of light. Please go out there. Jesus did not die in a house. He died out on a hill. with his hand stretched to the world. So it's out there that you need to go and stretch your hands to the world and bring the harvest in. God bless you as you do that. So today, from Dominion Church, till we meet again next week, we say Shalom. God richly bless you. Amen.